Hollywood career. I want to touch at least a little bit on your stage career.
Well, I should hope so, because as far as I'm concerned, I'm an actress. I just do it a lot of places. I'm not a movie star, not in my mind.
Actress is a much better thing to be. How did you end up in Oklahoma? I hear it was very kind of a propitious thing that happened there.
Well, first of all, there was a war, and World War II. And the gift that we had for the armed services was the stage door canteen. So I was playing in a play by John Van Druten, a comedy, and I was waiting on table at the stage door canteen, we all gave our time voluntarily to try to provide the soldiers with a warm, cozy, welcoming kind of place for them to be in such a big, dirty, frightening city, coming as they did from so many different types of backgrounds. So I realized very quickly that what they enjoyed the most was when people would come from the musicals and do hit songs that they had heard back home. And there was a tremendous demand for publicity, for entertainment in camps and hospitals. So I realized if I were going to be worth a damn, I'd better be in a musical. So I called my grandmother, who was a critic. I mean, she was a real one. She was paid for it, not like the rest of us. And she, of course, had seen everything. And I had read in the New York Times that Richard Rodgers and Oscar Hammerstein were going to be making a musical from a play called Green Grow the Lilacs by Lynn Riggs. So I called her and I said, Nana, tell me about Green Grow the Lilacs. Oh, she said, it's a darling play. Darling! Well, I said, why wasn't it a hit? Well, she said, I suppose it's because they used old folk songs like On Top of Old Smoke, you know, that everybody'd heard and was kind of bored with. But she said, you know, if Mr. Rodgers and Mr. Hammerstein do the job that they are capable of, this could be the most marvelous show for right this minute. When so many young people are going out to fight for this country and maybe die for it, to be reminded of the values that settled the West. And so, thus fortified, I called my friend over at the Theater Guild. Now, I had done three plays for them already, starting with The Time of Your Life, which won the Critics Award and the Pulitzer Prize. And so I said to Elaine Anderson, who later married John Steinbeck, Elaine, when is the next audition for Richard Rodgers? She said, why? She was from Texas. And I said, because I want to sing for it. She said, can you sing? Well, I said, of course I can sing. When my father first came from Norway, she said, honey, I don't care about your father. I'm talking about you now, can you sing? And I said, yes, I've been studying. She said, all right, next Thursday at St. James Theater, bring your music and know your keys. I said, yes, ma'am. So then I called my singing teacher. And I said, Clytie, I'm going to be auditioning for Richard Rodgers. She said, well, it's about time. Well, she was from Australia. So she said, what are you going to sing? Well, I said, what should I sing? Well, don't sing a Richard Rodgers song. I said, oh, no. She said, he gets terribly upset. If you don't dot the quarter note, he gets very thrown off and doesn't pay any attention to you, just thinks you've ruined his song. And she said, don't choose a rival composer's either. Well, I said, she said, sing something you've known since you were 12. So I went to the St. James Theater in the pouring rain, carrying my music like school books. And I was standing in the left wing, looking on the stage. There was a girl on stage singing, making the most awful faces. And I thought, I remembered when my father said, it's always got to be easy. You know, ours is the only work besides musicians that is called playing. And it isn't art until it is playing. But that takes a lot of rehearsal. I mean, you can be either spontaneous, which is, but you have to rehearse it so you can get back all that spontaneity, and then the audience wants to get right up on the stage with you. So I heard my friend say, thank you very much, we'll let you know. And the girl left, and then I heard her say, you're just gonna die when you hear who's gonna sing next. And he said, who? She said, Celeste Holm. He said, can she sing? She says, I don't know. She says she can. Well, he said, you know, if she could, she'd be just great for you know what. Well, she came running backstage, beating me. She'd be great. It's a wonderful part. Well, in my excitement, I didn't see that there were three steps leading down onto the stage. I did. Flat. And my belt busted, the final indignity. So I was picking up the music and picking up the belt, and this voice in the front said, "That's pretty funny. Could you do it again?" I said, "I'd rather not." So then he said, "My name is Richard Rogers. What are you going to sing?" And I said, "My name is Celeste Holm. Who is Sylvia?" By Shakespeare and Schubert. Well, you can't get any less competitive than that. So he said, "I haven't heard that this year." So then he let me sing the entire three choruses, and I had never sung better in my life. And so he said, "My God." I said, "Is that good?" He said, "You have a trained voice." And I said, "Haven't I?" Well, the reason I said that was I was just as surprised as he was at how well it had gone. But you see, I wasn't nervous. Once you fall on your face, what's to be nervous about? You got nowhere to go but up. So then he said, "Could you sing as if you'd never had a lesson in your life?" I said, "I don't know. What does that sound like?" He said, "I want a bald, bold, unedited farm girl voice." I said, "We have a farm, and I can call a hog." He said, "I dare you." So on the stage of the St. James Theater, I said, "Sweet!" None came. But he said, "Well, that's loud enough, and that's funny enough, and that's how I got my job in Oklahoma."
Did it ever strike you as ironic that later on, when you started doing films, your image was always this elegant, ladylike person? And here's
yes, there. Rather. Yes, it did. Because, well, I mean, Mr. Zanuck was absolutely astonished that I wore shoes, because he had signed me, sight unseen, he'd never seen me in Oklahoma, or Bloomer Girl, and or anything. And he heard that I sang a song called "I Can't Say No," and I think he hoped it was true. And I think he was surprised that I wore shoes with that. And then he heard that I could speak French. Well, it just threw him completely. But then I did two terrible musicals before I did Gentleman's Agreement. I was signed by Mr. Zanuck as a threat to Betty Grable. Truly. Which, if I had known, I would never have agreed to. But that was what he did. He always wanted to keep his actors nervous. He signed Betty Grable as a threat to Alice Faye. He signed me as a threat to Betty Grable, thinking that this would get the best. It doesn't ever get anything good out of anybody to feel threatened. He should have known that. But, of course, moguls aren't supposed to know much. They don't, really. I don't know how they do as well as they do, quite frankly. I think it's because they hire talented other people and then take the credit for it, for the most part.
Tell me about Zanuck's mogul mode.
Well, that was it. He was, my first interview with him was utterly ridiculous. I met him at a party, and I was wearing a low-cut dress, something I never did again. And he seemed to be more interested in the low-cut dress than he was in me. I mean, this part of me. So I didn't like that much. He said, "Why haven't you been in to see me?" I said, "Because you haven't asked me. I never go when I'm not where I'm not asked." And he said, "Come and see me anytime. You're one of my biggest stars." So about a week later, I thought, this is it. So I went into his office with a suit tied to the gloves, hat. Now, of course, we don't do that in California now. But then there were still, you know, some leftovers from New York who did. And his secretary said, "Who shall I say is calling?" She knew perfectly well who I was. But that's called trying to make the New York actor feel insecure. Because the moment a new person comes on the lot, everybody knows it. Everybody goes to lunch. Everybody stares. Everybody whispers. So she said, "You may go in." That's funny because I never saw her communicate with him. I don't know what she did. Maybe there was a camera somewhere. I have no idea. All I know is that the door clicked open and I opened it. And it shut behind me, and there was another door in front of me which was locked. I was in an air lock. And suddenly my heart started going, brrr. You know, I've never been afraid. I'm not afraid of anything. But that was new and threatening in some funny way. So I opened the door, and when I'm very nervous, I get very brave. So I threw open the door, And way down at the other end was this huge white desk and a little man sitting behind it. The office was long and in dark green and cream, very Williamsburg. And we were doing a movie at the moment called Three Little Girls in Blue. I was the one in red. And it was supposed to be taking place in about 1908. So I said, all bravery and apprehension, I said, why don't we shoot the picture here? It's the right period. He said, wouldn't it be practical? And I thought, oh boy, no humor. So I said, which is the most comfortable chair? He said, mine, but it's not available. I couldn't believe this. I couldn't believe it. So I said, well, then I'll just have to settle for this one, I guess. I said, you know, I have just come from being overseas, where I entertained thousands of soldiers at several large encampments. And I said, you know, every station, the atmosphere of every station was a reflection of the commanding officer. And since I've been here, I want to tell you that I have been all around this studio. I've been to every department. That's what I do when you call me at 6 o'clock in the morning, and then I get my face painted and have to sit around. And he said, why? Well, I said, it's a new business for me. I said, I don't know how it works. I want to understand everything. But all I can tell you is everyone has been wonderful to me. Bobby McLean has taught me how to cut a picture. And the music department, of course, has this marvelous record and all these marvelous musicians. And the old sets left over from pictures that I remember, and the prop department. But of course, the most wonderful is the special effects. I mean, they can do miracles. And I said, you know, I don't understand how you make an artistic decision at all. He said, what do you mean? Well, I said, you can have a train wreck or an avalanche or a plague of locusts. And I said, if you have no limitation, how can you make a decision? In the theater, all we have is that little box. We have to do it all with that. And he said, it's not easy. I felt as if I were climbing a mountain backwards on roller skates. So then I said, is that a Paul Clemens behind you? He said, you know painting? I said, my mother's a painter. Oh. I said, is that your wife? And it looked, the expression of the picture was, don't hit me, which told me more than I wanted to know. And I said, I think he does very, very, very good work. So I think I said next, I loved Wilson. Now that happened to be his favorite picture, and it had been a flop. But now he thought I was conning him. I didn't know that. All I knew was I had loved Wilson. I questioned the choice of Alexander Knox in the part because I didn't think enough people knew him. And if it had been an actor everybody knew, it might have done more for the picture. And then there was another deadly pause, and I said, well, thank you so much for your time. I have appreciated this. He said, come in anytime, anytime. Oh, I forgot to tell you when I first walked in. He said, it's a wonderful office. He said, there's more. And he opened the door behind his desk, and here was a bed, and he went like this. And I said, oh, for when you get tired, and sat down. Then came the rest of the interview, and then I left. And over 2 more years after that, we would see each other in public places, and he would always wave and smile and say something that was supposed to be funny. Because he knew that I was had a sense of humor, but it was always, you know, kind of off the mark. It was a strange relationship.
Strange man.
Yes.
When you signed your contract at 20th Century Fox, were you afraid of being typecast?
I didn't know what I was afraid of. I only knew that Oscar Hammerstein said, you'll have a very difficult time. They're not going to understand you. And he said, you're so defenseless, and people don't understand that. And anyway, I was rescued from this fate worse than death by Moss Hart, who wrote Gentleman's Agreement. And
Did you have to fight for that role?
No, Moss asked me for it. I was doing a benefit at the Beverly Wilshire Hotel for the Lambs Club, which was a men's club, but they were in so much difficulty that they were even asking women to help them. And so I didn't eat before it, because I never ate before a benefit. You never know what a benefit's going to do. The lights fall down or so, you know. So afterwards, we went over to the Brown Derby, and we were having, you know, scrambled eggs or something. And sitting across from me was an absolute typecast picture of a Hollywood author. He was in a tweed jacket and a silk foulard and a three-day beard, and it was Moss Hart, whom I knew. And he said, "Celeste, have you ever read Gentleman's Agreement?" I said, "I haven't read it. I've never even heard of it." He said, "I'll send it to you in the morning. Read it and call me." So at 9 o'clock, the book came. By 1 o'clock, I'd finished it, and I called him, and I said, "Yes, any part, anything." He said, "Ann Detry." I said, "Oh, boy." So then he told Zanuck that he wanted me to play it. Zanuck said, "She can't do that. She's done musical kind." He said, "She started in Shakespeare. I know her very well." So he made me do emotional scene at the end first as a sort of screen test, because I didn't know that. But there's this funny story about that. When I got my first job in New York, which was a tryout of a rather secondary play, I'm going to be in Locust Valley, and my father had given me a car when I graduated from high school, and you only had to be 16 to drive a car in Chicago. So I would drive to rehearsal every day from Brooklyn, where I was living with my grandparents, and I'd go up 2nd Avenue, and all the streets were two-way then. I tried to go three blocks. Now I'm under the L on 3rd Avenue, and I tried to go seven blocks before the light chase. Well, all of a sudden, I'm at a light, and a guy in a car beside me, here, in a black car, and he had a young man beside him and his mother in the back seat. There was no doubt about that. And he said, "Excuse me, what are you doing this afternoon?" And I said, from the security of my own car and my own job, I said, "I'm going to rehearsal." He said, "Oh, you're an actress." I said, "Don't you think that's a good idea?" He said, "It depends." The light changed. So now I got to catch up with him again. And so I said, "What did you have in mind about this afternoon?" And he said, "Well," he said, "my mother is going to Radio City Music Hall, and she'd like to know whether you'd like to go with her." Well, I said, "That's very sweet, thank you. But no, I have to go to rehearsal." I said, "Matter of fact," I said, "my mother and my grandmother are going to Radio City Music Hall this afternoon." "Well," he said, "if you get the chance, come to the stage door and ask for Vincent Minnelli." Now, 2 years before that, my grandmother had taken us on a tour of Radio City Music Hall. We saw where the Rockettes took their naps. All kinds of exciting things like that. And it was quite impressive where they made ice and there were three stages and blah, blah, blah. Well, we were led around by the most gorgeous young man. Dark, handsome, slender, white gloves, navy jacket, gold buttons, fourragère, oh boy. So at the end of the tour, my grandmother, who, as you can imagine, was never shy, said, "Tell me, young man, you're not going to do this for the rest of your life, are you?" And he said, "Certainly not, I'm an actor." "Oh," she said, "I'm so glad. You have just the right equipment. Tell me your name so we can keep track of you." And so he told her his name. I didn't pay any attention. So then, here we are now, and I go to rehearsal, and they didn't want me at rehearsal. They were rehearsing other scenes. So I went over, parked right next to Radio City Music Hall. You could do that then. And I got up, there was a big sign saying, "Radio City and Artistic Director Vincent Minnelli." See, I didn't know that. So I went to the stage door, and there was a very nice doorman, Pop. And I said, "Would you tell Mr. Minnelli that the lady in the car is here?" And he laughed, and he called upstairs and said, "You may go in." So I went into the main hall, and here was this gorgeous young man that had taken us on the tour 2 years before. And I said, "Oh," I said, "excuse me, I know you don't remember me, but my mother and my grandmother..." He said, "Of course I do. They just spoke to me. I took them up to the second floor, second balcony." And I said, "What aisle?" He said, "Six." I said, "Thank you." So I ran upstairs in the dark and went down the... And there was my mother, went and sat there. She said, "How did you find us?" I said, "Nana's boyfriend." So now the first day of Gentleman's Agreement shooting, while we're doing the last scene the next day, Mr. Kazan, Ilya Kazan, said, I want to take you in to meet Gregory Peck, because we're going to be rehearsing tomorrow's shooting. And so when I went into his trailer, I said, I don't suppose you remember when my grandmother asked you whether you were going to be a guide for the rest of your life at Radio City Music Hall. Of course, he pretended to remember. I don't think he really did.
Everybody's got an Oscar story, everyone who's won one. Look, can we hear yours?
Yes, certainly. I made the dress that I was going to wear at the Academy that night because I could not find the one I wanted. When I had first met Lynn Fontanne, she was wearing pearl gray and pearls. And that's the way I wanted to look. Of course, I should have considered that maybe I didn't look as well in gray as she did, but that was the image that I wanted. So I worked on the dress, and I was up until 2 o'clock in the morning the night before sewing the ruffles on the petticoat. Anyway, it was all very never-never land. I got a letter, of course, from the Academy 5 weeks before saying you have already won one of the highest awards you can get, which is the nomination, and from your peers. And however, if the miracle should happen, that your name should be called out, go straight up the aisle and climb the stairs onto the stage. Do not stop and talk to friends, and there will be a star on the stage. You stand on the star and face the audience. Well, when I read that, I realized how few movie stars are stage-oriented. So then it said, prepare a speech of no more than, I think it was 45 seconds. Well, I just dismissed that because Ethel Barrymore was there. And I thought with all those years of servitude and tenure and all that, that she, of course, would be the obvious choice. Well, that's what I thought. So I didn't prepare anything. I took a nap, or tried to, after we'd had some soup. I wasn't up to eating. And I thought about sort of what I ought to say, but I didn't put it into words. Because, you know, well, I was sitting in the seat. Now, the Academy couldn't have thought I was going to win. I wasn't even on the aisle. So when he called out my name, mispronouncing it, all of a sudden I thought I'd lost my mind, because every light in the theater hits you. You're blinded and numbed. And so my husband said, get up. I said, I can't. My knees are caramel. So at that point, somebody was on the other side, I don't know who it was, and the two of them heisted me to my feet. And I walked down, scrunched by all those people and up the aisle, and onto the stage, and there was the star, and I turned around, faced the audience, and suddenly realized I hadn't prepared. But something came to mind. And what I said was, I thought I'd already received the greatest reward in having the opportunity of being in a picture which can bring understanding to a world that seems to need it so much. Because it was, as you know, a very serious examination of anti-Semitism. And then I burst into tears and ran off the stage. There was a publicist there, a lovely old man named Gabe York, who'd come to see me one day while I was shooting on the set, and he sat down beside me between takes and said, what are you doing here? Well, I said, I'm making a picture. He said, I know that, but he said, what do you want to do here? I said, I want to make pictures that change people's hearts. He said, from Hollywood? I said, I could try. So when I ran off stage, his was the first person. His was the first face I saw. He said, you did it. Then I had to walk into a room full of the press and say, what are you going to do next? I had no idea. Maybe eat something.
You know, your next picture, I'm not sure if it was your next picture, but certainly it was soon after, was another picture that really was dealt with a serious social issue, Snake Pit.
I made that at the same time. In fact, I'd already been told I was going to be doing Gentleman's Agreement. And then I read that they were going to be doing Snake Pit. And I had read that book. And I was so moved by the state of the mentally ill in this country. It's still true. Nobody speaks for them. You got Liz Taylor talking for AIDS. But nobody's speaking for the mentally ill. Nobody wants to deal with it. It embarrasses them. It frightens them. and they need the understanding. So I want to be in that picture. So I told my agent, I said, tell Mr. Zanuck I want to be in that picture. He said, no. I said, no, what do you mean no, you're my agent? He said, I don't want you to be in that, it's an unpleasant subject. I said, please. Well, he said, I'm not gonna do it, what do you know about that? So 2 days later, I found myself in the administration building, which we used to call the Iron Lung. I never knew why. And I was going upstairs to the publicity department about something, and there was Anatole Litvak in the elevator with me. He was going to direct it. So I pressed the stop button behind his head, and the car stopped between the second and third floors. And he said, we are stuck. I said, yes, I have to talk to you. And he said, oh, I said, I want to be in the snake pit. He said, why? He said, because I think it's going to be a very important picture. I said, I just feel that not enough people understand about mental illness. He said, what would you play? I already have Olivia there. I said, anything. I don't really care. But I said, I just want to be part of it. He said, would you shave off all your hair and block out your teeth? Well, I said, that's just makeup. And I said, easiest thing I do is grow hair. So he said, all right, I'll tell Mr. Zanuck. I think of you as musical. I said, please. I started in Shakespeare. And so he said, all right. So then I pressed the button. He said, you did that deliberately. I said, of course. How else was I going to talk to you? Oh, he said, now you have got the job. And so we made them at the same time. It was very interesting because the set was crawling with psychiatrists. And I got an insight into the relationship between prejudice and mental illness, because most of us are afraid of that which we do not understand or which we feel threatened by. So I had that privilege.
Wonderful film. Let me talk a little about All About Eve, because that's another one that you are so well known for.
And I'm the only living leftover.
I guess you are. The writing in that.
Ah, wasn't it marvelous? And you know, my agent didn't want me to do it. He didn't think it was, he thought I'd get caught between Bette Davis and Eve, not realizing that this was the balance wheel. And, oh my, but the character delineation and the brilliance of the wit of the lines. Oh, Zanuck, Mankiewicz was marvelous, just marvelous. He knew everything. He knew more about the use of camera than anyone I ever worked with. He would stop us in the middle of a scene and say, I'm not going to stop the camera, but he put his hand over the camera and he'd say, now pick up here. We'd rehearse it enough so that we could do that. And he said, I'm not giving the cutter one frame that I don't want used. He said, it's my decision, not his.
What about Bette Davis? Was she intimidating?
She was the rudest woman I ever met. She was rude to me the first day on the set. I don't know whether you can use this or not. But I had so looked forward to working with her. And I said when I met her, I said, I can hardly wait for... She said, I feel quite the same way. Then we got to the set, and I walked on, and I said, good morning. And she said, oh, shit, good manners. And I never spoke to her again.
Sure,
except in this part.
Sure couldn't tell from your performance. You could have been the best buddy.
Such good actresses. Oh, but you know, I think if that had not been true, it might have been even better.
I love the scene where you finally realize that you didn't have to do what you did when you're sitting there laughing. That is so, you're so great in that moment.
Mankiewicz knew that Betty had been rude to me. So he said, now I want you to laugh. I want you to laugh when you realize that all you've gone through was completely So I said, oh, okay. So he started the camera, and I said, you know. So she's just looking at me. So then he signaled me to calm down. So I stopped. She said, I can't do that. Oh, I said, I'm sure you could if you tried. She said, no, I can't. I said, think of the things that you can do that I can't do. At which point, Mr. Mankiewicz said, want to do it again? I said, why not? And off I went. But anyway, that was kind of fun.
Okay, you weren't under contract at MGM, were you?
No, by that time, the studio system had sort of calmed down. And I'd walked out on my contract with Zanuck. I found a loophole and ran. And so then I was hired to do Tender Trap, which was a delicious picture. It had a point. And I was with Frank Sinatra and David Wayne, whom I adored. We had been together in Summer Stock many years before. But it was really a charming, charming picture. And then, of course, I did, this was directed by Chuck Walters. And then, of course, came High Society with Grace Kelly and Bing Crosby and Frank Sinatra. Of course, working with Bing and Frank was like working with Seconal and Benzedrine. Because Frank would say, "Now, okay, let's go. Bing would say, "Would you like to rehearse it one more time?" And I'd say, "Yes, please." Anyway, I always liked to know what I was doing. I like to have that sense of complete freedom that you have when you know what you're doing. And Sinatra, on the other hand, went after the spontaneity and see what happens, you know? So it's just a different way of working. People ask me how I got along with Frank Sinatra. I always say I always get along well with children. Because that's part of his charm. That's exactly what it is. He's got a kind of kid quality that's quite wonderful. And of course, he sang beautifully. The atmosphere on that set was marvelous. Of course, that was when Grace was getting engaged to her prince. I remember she asked me that I was going to the Red Book Awards that night. There's so many awards now, you know, the Meat Market Award. And she said, I said, "Well, I'm not sure I'm going. Depends upon our call. If we have an early call, no." She said, "Well, it's the same with me." I said, "Who will you be going with?" She said, "My prince." And I thought, what a dumb question. Why did I say that? Who else would it be? But, you know, the rest of us were all singing, "Someday, my prince." Only it really happened. And one day, about 2 days later, she said to Chuck Walters, "May I wear my engagement ring in the picture?" Well, he said, "I don't know. Let's see it." She came in the next day with a skating rink. You know, it was from here to here. It was beautiful. It was the most beautiful diamond I've ever seen. I'm not really crazy about single diamonds. They say they're cold. But this had a lot of color. It was just beautiful. It had apparently belonged to his mother. So she said, and she came in with it, and we said, "Oh, Grace!" She said, "It is sweet, isn't it?" Well, we never let her up on that sweet little ring. Anyway, we all got along beautifully. I adored her. She was thoroughly and constantly considerate of other people first. So as far as I was concerned, she was a princess long before she married a prince. And we had a very good time on that picture. Then one day, toward the end of the picture, she asked me to lunch with Mr. Sherry and her future father-in-law and the prince, and a couple of characters, I don't know who they were. They were producers. And Chuck Walters. So I was very nervous about Chuck because he never said anything without a four-letter word in it. And that made me nervous. But I found out that day at lunch that he was born in Pasadena and knew how to behave himself if he wanted to. Because he didn't say anything wrong at all. Anyway, conversation was kind of lumping along. I was sitting next to Dory on his left, Grace was on his right, and then came the prince's father, and then came the prince, and then, you know, and then these two jokers, as I say, and then Chuck Walters. And, let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 8. And the room was terribly small. The waiters had a terrible time getting around behind us. And suddenly, I don't know who said, it must have been one of those, said, "How big is Monaco?" Well, there was a sort of stumpy pause. And then I think he gave it to us in feet because we were all doing arithmetic. And suddenly Dory laughed. And he said, "Well, that's not even as big as our back lot." I felt as though a crystal chandelier had suddenly smashed right into the middle of the table into 1,000 pieces. So I stuck my fork in my steak and pushed my steak across the table. Well, it certainly was a diversionary action, and it served to get everybody's attention for a while. And I said, you see, Grace, you can't take me anywhere. Anything, anything to get on and over. And I knew then that Grace would never make another picture, because I knew that neither of those princes would agree to her working with such careless people, tactless people.
Amazing story. Mm. Amazing.
Yeah.
Was it fun to do a musical again after not doing any in Hollywood for so long?
Well, yeah, sure, certainly. But then I'd gone and done The King and I in the meantime, and, you know, I'd done others. King and I think is my favorite performance, production. The relationship between those two, that man who thought he knew everything and she who thought she knew everything, and then when they met, the gradual understanding of each other, I thought was beautiful.
Even more than than Oklahoma?
Well, Oklahoma was a kind of paean of praise to America and to this country and to the soil from which we all spring. But the other was a more intellectual experience. And of course the children were so wonderful. I loved the children, so they would kiss me goodnight every night. They would line up and kiss me goodnight. My uncle came from Norway. He came on an ambassador's permit. He sold a Guidler. It was a thing that controlled conveyor belts to General Motors. And he was standing in the door and he said, you know, my grandmother, your mother would not have, my mother would not have approved of your being an actress. She did not believe in pretense. But I said, your father was a minister. It's one thing to feel faith, it's another to be able to give it to other people. Well, he was terrified by that thought, to think of his father as an actor. So then he came, I said, but you see, we pretend something, an unreal thing, in order to tell a greater truth. And he said, ah. So then he was standing in the doorway of my dressing room, and the children were kissing me. He saw the show. And he said, oh, how my mother would have approved. I can't tell you how that pleased me. I, of course, was very fortunate in that my parents, my mother was a painter, my aunt was on the stage, and as I say, my father was Norwegian, that they were all so interested in so many things. And when I wanted to be an actress, nobody seemed surprised. I think actually they were kind of pleased because I had a focus. I already knew when I was 2.5 years old what I wanted to do.
Really?
She took me to see Anna Pavlova, and I saw a change take place in the audience. I saw a bunch of lumps sitting, you know, the way people sit on a bus, kind of, what the hell have you got that I haven't got expression? And then the miracle of the work. I mean, Anna Pavlova never touched the ground, I swear. She was just pink shimmer, twinkle. She was so totally at home with herself on the stage that she could do anything. And it was just a pleasure, so that you wanted to do it too. And so afterwards, the whole audience had changed. They were smiling at each other. They were helping each other on with their coats. It was as though, on some level, they had discovered what a gift it was to be human, to be able to do that. If they can do that, I ought to be able to do something, you know? So that's how I started, and that's where I still am. That's why I love it so much.
That's great. That's terrific. Wonderful. Thank you so much, Ms. Holm.
Thank you.